dreamer, but I'm not the only one.
Welcome back to Q&A. Yes, some of the scenes we've seen over the last couple of days, huge outpouring of grief and emotion from New Zealanders, quite extraordinary to these horrific events. Welcome back. Yes, we're staying with our coverage of the Christchurch Mosque shootings, and my next guest is Professor Paul Spoonley from Massey University. Professor, good evening to
you. Good evening, Corin.
I want to continue to talk about this issue of difficult stuff around white supremacy and the issues that we are being confronted with and the difficulties of hearing the Muslim community express the way they feel. You might not be so surprised, is that right?
I am not surprised. I mean, I've started looking at these groups in the early 1980s, so they've been part of my life for way too long, and there are some nasty, nasty people in New Zealand, and I think we need to talk more to some of the groups like you've been talking tonight, some of the, in this case, Muslim community, to hear their stories about what life is like in New Zealand when they're targeted by Islamophobia.
How many of the white supremacist groups, how many people are we talking about?
I would say 200 to 250, with possibly another couple of hundred around the edges of it. It goes up and down a wee bit, and the numbers fluctuate, and sometimes they're in groups and sometimes they're not. They're just simply individuals who hold those beliefs.
Are we talking about radicalised extremists here who are capable of doing what we've seen over the last couple of days?
Absolutely, absolutely. And Corin, can I just say, we don't have a memory of what happens in this country. So let's talk about Wayne Motts, who was killed in Christchurch in 1989 by a neo-Nazi skinhead who then killed himself. And we had that image of him being buried, the Nazi being buried, with people giving Nazi salutes at the graveside, all dressed in black. Let's talk about the Korean backpacker. Let's talk about the gay man, all killed by white supremacists in this country.
But there have been people, and there are, to push back, there are people saying this guy came from Australia,
yep,
that he wasn't from Christchurch, mm-hmm, he was residing in Dunedin.
Yeah.
What would you say to them?
I think they're missing the point. The atrocity, the murders that occurred in this country. This country provided him with an environment that allowed him, is the wrong word, but gave him an opportunity to commit mass murder in our country. So why aren't we taking more notice of these groups as a threat?
Okay, let me just roll that back.
What
would be the environment where he wouldn't have been able to do it? What would be the ideal environment that would have stopped him?
Okay, the gun, I'm not an expert on gun laws, but I fully support the Prime Minister and the Cabinet's approach to looking at those gun laws. We need to have a look at our hate law speech. You asked Anjum previously about whether anybody had been prosecuted. Do you know when the last prosecution for hate speech in this country was?
I think I might have read something, I can't remember.
1977, yeah, when two neo-Nazis were prosecuted for anti-Semitic pamphlet here in Auckland. And yes, one of the people who appears to be on the fringes of this event is going to be prosecuted again. It's a long time between drinks. We're not closing down.
So you're saying that if there was a much less tolerance for this stuff online, anywhere,
yeah,
that then sends a signal?
Well, I think there are other things in this mix, and one of them is monitoring what happens online. And I heard the minister before, and I think the review is going to be really important. In my own experience, the security agencies are looking at these groups, but they don't have enough resources. And so if you heard the minister, a lot of what he was talking about were tip-offs. That's way too passive for me. They should be monitoring what's happening online and assessing risk. And we've got to talk about the responsibility of the companies that provide these platforms.
Have they been... do you buy into this idea that they just had the, they haven't even had the focus right? They've been, for so long now, they've been preoccupied with extremist, fundamentalist, Islamic terror groups like ISIS,
yes,
and that has meant that they have not been focused in the right area.
I think that it's a bit hard to know. They have certainly approached me at times, and I've approached them because I've needed their support on occasions in this country. So I know that they're aware of the right-wing extremists that operate here, but I'm not sure there's sufficient resource given to monitoring
them. So they're coming to you, though?
They talk to a lot of different people.
Sure, and you're an expert in this area, but might you think that they go have their own resources to be able to, you know, monitor and dig into this stuff?
Let me give you an example, Corin. So somebody stole a neo-Nazi membership list, a membership list of a particular group. So I felt compelled to share that with our intelligence agencies. So that's the sort of thing that I would quite happily exchange information about.
Just before we go, has it changed globally in the last few years? We've seen President Trump, we've seen Charlottesville and these sort of episodes, mm-hmm. we've seen Brexit in the sense that there is a belief that perhaps there are communities who are feeling like the world globalisation has not served them well.
Yes.
And that is leading to some extreme nationalism in some parts of the world. Yeah. And is that a trend that the world is now starting to see, and it's unfortunately arrived in New Zealand?
Yes, it is. If you look at the populist anti-immigrant parties around the world, about a third of the Western democracies vote for those parties now. And that's up 7%, up from 7% in the last decade. I think the internet has changed things dramatically. And we're now seeing, as you saw in this particular incident, an internationalised ecosystem of supremacist views that are shared around the world. It's not confined to any particular country. And of course, the third thing is the Islamophobic content of this. When I started out, it was anti-Semitic. But now, all you need to do is look online. And when you look at hate speech in this country, then I think most of us would be very disturbed at the level of Islamophobic comment.
Professor Paul Spoonley, thank you very much from Massey University. We appreciate your time on Q&A.